So here with Lloyd Russell-Moyle, episode of local MP for Labour, Brighton Kemptown. Welcome back, Lloyd. Just come at the end of summer now. We're going to have a local update first. What's been going on locally in the constituency? Because there's been a bit of a lull, hasn't there, politically in Westminster, but I know locally there's a lot going on.
Well, there's lots of going on, of course. We now see the next stages of some of the Madeira Drive development. Of course, it opened up. I personally would have kept lots of it closed, but it opened up. You do have a new cycle lane there that broadly is working, and people are getting back to those businesses. And now, of course, there's going to be the next stage of that development. The proposed new blocks in the marina have gone to the Secretary of State for appeal. We suspect the Secretary of State will probably approve them. And that will be disappointing for some people, but will mean then there's more developments at the marina. And the BlackRock proposal remains controversial, and we're trying to slowly fight that, raise the issues of some of the contamination at the BlackRock site. So we've got lots of things around developments locally.
Yeah.
At the same time, the Boundary Commission have come down and said they're going to do a whole new boundary review, so all the wards might change. They might not, some of them, but lots of them might. Even the ones that are the right size will probably change, because there'll be a knock-on effect, because they'll be the wrong size, you know, if that makes sense, when you make the changes. And then, of course, we've got ongoing issues around our NHS, making sure that people can see their doctors and everything properly. And after a summer of COVID, that's been 2 years of COVID, I should now say, that's been quite difficult as well. So it's all kind of go on those fronts. As well as, of course, nationally, we've had a few kind of humdingers, even though we are on recess.
Exactly. Start off with what's going on down the marina, because I know that they were too late deciding that. The two blocks of flats that are going in there, aren't they? Two big towers, is that right?
So let's be clear, at the moment, there is planning permission for, if I remember rightly, I'm sure someone will correct me, a 90-storey block that already got permission. The proposal was to change that so that there was a smaller 40 building block and then a number of other blocks that were, I think it was something like 10 to 11 stories high, all around the marina arm there.
Yeah.
The council was delayed in responding, and then they decided they would have decided against anyway. Well, if you are delayed, or if the council voted against, either way, the developer can go to appeal.
Yep.
The developer's done that. That has now been heard by the Secretary of State as inspector, and the outcome will come back shortly. Bearing in mind, if this is rejected, they still have the original planning application, which is still for a skyscraper down at that, for Brighton terms, a very large building down at that block, which already was slightly controversial. Lots of people, remember, say, though, in the Act of Parliament, it says that there can be no buildings above the skyline. And if you remember, the actual Act says, because there was a big hoo-ha about this when the current
blocks... Above the cliffs.
Yeah. It says it cannot be built above the cliffs unless the Secretary of State agrees. Well, because this has now gone to the Secretary of State, it will be the Secretary of State agreeing. And if they agree, then you can build whatever height you want. You know, kind of. So it doesn't matter what the Act says. That was just about what the council could approve, not what the Secretary of State could approve.
Yeah.
So that's where we are with that. I mean, the whole thing is with the marina and the BlackRock area and Madeira Drive, they could be some fantastic assets for us if we really utilise them better in the city. But at the moment, it's all a bit disjointed, isn't it? You know, kind of. And so, you know, there are some people talking about a basketball arena down at BlackRock.
Yep.
Others have talked previously about skate rinks down there. There needs to be a joined-up plan. And I know the council is now thinking about what would go there long-term, and they've not made that their mind, and they're going to kind of open that up to a wider public discussion. But something, it seems to me that whole area from probably the yellow wave all the way down, including into the marina where you've got the David Lloyd and you've got the Tenpin Bowling and you've got the casino, is like a leisure sports area.
Yeah.
So we need to try and make sure that what goes there fits with that. And even the beach down there is slightly different. It's not a party beach.
No, it's more...
It's a leisure sports beach,
yeah.
isn't it?
Yeah.
Kayaking, canoeing, yeah. sunbathing in the nude, all of those things are leisure activities rather than party yeah. activities, aren't they? I mean, that's probably how
yeah.
I would describe...
Yeah, totally, yeah.
You know, kind of the volleyball and the new swimming lane that's going to be started
yeah.
to be built from this winter. And so from next summer, a 50-metre, this will be the first 50-metre pool that we have in Brighton, a 50-metre pool will now exist in Brighton. So those who want to swim on the Olympic standard will be able to do so. Very exciting.
Yeah, exactly. And what do you think about the basketball arena going there? Because I've spoken to Ricky Perrin from Sussex Wheelchair Basketball, Sussex Bears Basketball. Do you have a view on that at all? Because the kind of people behind it want a 3,000 capacity arena down there, bringing the Brighton Bears back.
Oh, well, the Brighton Bears are back now
yeah.
because, of course, they're playing at the University of Sussex.
Yeah,
and I know that the yeah. council is keen to see whether they can make space for the Brighton Bears to start playing again at the Brighton Centre.
Yeah.
So let's get them back. I think it's not quite the same journey as the Albion, but if we look at the journey from the Albion
yeah.
when they were away, when they went to Withdean, it was suboptimal, but it was about also showing that there was local support and a need for a local venue here. So I think the Brighton Bears need to show that they've got the support locally. They had originally put forward a proposal that would be an ice rink and a basketball arena and possibly some activities on top. So you dig down
yeah.
and you build a few. Now, to me, that would be a much better use of facilities, something that is multi-use. We desperately need an ice rink in this city, a proper,
yeah.
decent, hockey-sized ice rink. We need, of course, a nice basketball arena would be very useful. And possibly, probably in that area, need something that is outward-facing. Because the problem with building those things there is you're right on the sea. Let's make the most of that space. So you don't want to build just a venue that is internally looking.
Yeah.
You know, I always think that about the Odeon. On the front,
yeah,
it's got yeah. one window, and that's it. And it's probably got the prime location of the whole city. So I do think we need to be careful about not using that prime location for something that's inward looking only. So
yeah.
what's there has to also look outwards, and it has to bring in the nature, as well as the cliffs and the marina, and link those two together. It's got a really important role. I think that the basketball venue is one of the keys to it. If it was just a basketball venue, I suspect that would be a little bit of a waste of space. And the other thing to say, of course, is that a basketball venue needs to be commercially viable. This is not free building here.
Yeah.
Someone needs to pay for it.
Yeah, exactly. Gasworks, is there any news on the gasworks there? Because that's a bit of a contentious issue, isn't it, really?
No, well, the developer is working up its proposals.
Yeah.
They haven't yet gone and received planning permission. Again, the council owns a few bits of land around the site, but not huge amounts. So it's mainly in the hands of the developer who has signed a deal with the owner of these sites across the country. Now, the problem with it is that unlike some of the areas where there are big gas works that are just in commercial area settings, this is right next to a residential area. And so it's how you excavate the site in a sympathetic way and then how you build in a sympathetic way as well. The highest density of housing in this city, so remember, is Hanover and Elm Grove. Or Hanover,
yeah,
which is low stories, one or two, three-story buildings, maybe four
yeah.
max. Yeah, if you think about basement and attic. But they are dense, squeezed in. That's some of the most desirable areas of the city. And tower blocks, actually, don't provide always the same level of density because you have to have space between them, you have to have the air circulating and all those kind of things. So it might well be that there are solutions for that site that don't have to be high-rise, that can still be just a dense.
Yeah.
It could be, and my view would be, that there are solutions in that site that could involve more commercial activities. and then we use some of the commercial activities that would have been moved from the marina for that to be house building, for example. You know, kind of Asda could move there, or a supermarket or something like that. So there are many options that you could think of for that site. I hope that the developer thinks creatively, particularly around community spaces and community space. I think that's important. But the biggest concern is about pollution and about the disruption, because there is lots of very toxic chemicals in that ground. And you can, if you're building low rise or medium rise, just basically cap that ground, put a layer of concrete and cap it all off. As soon as you start building higher up, you have to dig further down.
Yes, exactly.
And as soon as you start digging further down, you create the pollution problem.
Exactly. Moving along the road a bit, Sussex County, the new hospital, virtually, when's that going to be ready? Do we know yet?
It's been a little delayed because of a mixture of Brexit and COVID.
Right.
I think we're all experiencing this at the moment, aren't we, in one way or another?
Yeah.
And so that has now been delayed for the first stage. So you've got the new hospital plus the vanity project of the helicopter pad, which is the most ugly part of Brighton at the moment, and that's not going to improve. That's the finished. The helicopter pad is the finished item.
Yeah.
And I mean, from a visual point of view, it's a disgrace. And from
it's quite tall.
Well, it's not just quite tall. Yeah. It's not clad. It's not covered in white. It doesn't fit with the rest of the skyline.
Yeah.
It's a structure that has been built totally unsympathetically in a heritage area.
Kemptown Conservation Area. Exactly. You can.
And I mean, the new hospital is built in a nice style.
Yeah.
That helipad is not built with any kind of cladding. It doesn't look like it fits in the building. You can see it from when you're coming to the city. So from a visual point of view, it's a disgrace. From a practical point of view, it will be rarely used. It will be used some of the time. But was it worth the money? I personally, and when I speak to people who are senior in the hospital, they probably said, if it's a case of what's best for saving lives, you know, you have a fixed amount of money and you can save the number of lives with it, we probably could have saved more lives if we'd spent it on something else in the hospital. It was a vanity project for the management of the hospital to say, we've got a helipad. At the moment, the helipad arrangements is not perfect, but East Brighton Park actually works relatively well. It's not perfect, but in terms of you have a fixed amount of money, how many lives do you save? That's the equation. The next stage of the hospital is that they will knock down the old Barry building.
Yeah.
Now, that's a great shame, of course. Barry building is built by the same person who built and designed Houses of Parliament.
Yeah.
It is the oldest building in the NHS estate, the oldest building currently used as a hospital in Britain, and of course built before Florence Nightingale.
Yeah.
That also gives you an idea of some of the problems with that building. You know, Florence Nightingale pioneered the idea that you need ventilation, you need space, and there isn't ventilation and space. And actually a large number, I think almost a majority, if I remember rightly, of people who died of COVID in the first wave here in Brighton died because they caught it in the Barry building in the Royal Sussex.
Right.
Because of the bad ventilation. So it is a dangerous building. So it's going to be knocked down, and the second phase will be built there. There's some discussions now about moving the A&E to that part of the new building.
Because I know there's extra money for a new A&E, 30 million odd.
So it might well be that we move the A&E to this side, that side of the site, and then that frees up the A&E part of the site to then for the cancer facilities, for example. So there's some rejigging that's happening there, but that will be very positive, hopefully. But it has always been, I'm a neighbour, basically, of the site, so I kind of talk just as the MP, but also as a concerned resident. Look, that's going to be a lot more disruption, but in the end, that will be positive. Now, I think what's interesting is the Conservative Party, nationally, have been saying, we're building X number of new hospitals. Well, is that a new hospital that's being built, or are we refurbishing an old hospital? Are we rebuilding a hospital? Now, when someone says we are building 40 new hospitals, it sounds to me like they are building new hospitals in addition to the hospitals that exist. Actually, what we're doing in the Royal Sussex, but the government's going to claim that as a new hospital, is we are rebuilding an old hospital, aren't we?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. We're going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more to Lloyd Russell-Moyle, MP, about national and local issues. Back here with Lloyd Russell-Moyle for the second half of the vote. We're going to go on to national issues. Afghanistan, bit of a disaster, isn't it? I mean, what's your view on that? I mean, I know our armed forces have done a good job.
Well, they've done the best they could under the circumstances, of course. And they've evacuated about 14,000 people, I think, have been evacuated overall. I think the example that needs to be looked at is France. Now, France knew the same timetable as we did. They have a coalition partner. They started evacuating already 2 months before Britain did. And the French prioritised Afghans in the first tranche, so the cooks, the cleaners, the translators. They were all evacuated first, the French contingent. And then they only left people who were French. They're easier to get out, actually. Like we're finding now, the Taliban will let out Brits, but they're now saying we might not let out some of the Afghanis who helped you. So the French knew that, and that's why they did it the other way around. We've known for almost a year now that this evacuation was going to happen. Yes, we didn't think that Afghanistan would fall so quickly, but we all knew that it would fall. Trump had negotiated with the Taliban, for goodness sake, knowing that the government that we'd put up was a puppet. Let's remember, great things had been achieved in terms of gender equality and improving rights for people. But the unemployment rate was skyrocketed, much higher than it had ever been under our leadership. It was one of the most corrupt governments in the world, according to the corruption indices that are run by USA-supported organisations. The freedom indices that talk about country free say it was one of the least free places in the world. It was still illegal, and you could be hung for being gay in Afghanistan. This is the government that we supported was doing all that, you know, kind of where unemployment was almost at 70% in parts of Afghanistan. This was the government that we had supported, that we, it was not a success. We absolutely failed in nation building. I believe sometimes you do need to nation build. I do believe sometimes you need to support countries and support people who are fighting fascism and fighting, you know, kind of backward ideologies that are dangerous for our world. But you cannot do it and then impose people that are corrupt, as we imposed, into Afghanistan. At the last elections, 1 million people voted out of a country of over 30 million adults. Only 1 million people voted. It wasn't democratic. It wasn't a democratic country. And anyone that says we had created it as a democratic country is living on cloud cuckoo land. We, as a country and as the allies, absolutely failed in Afghanistan, and our leaving of Afghanistan is just another of the long list of absolute failures in that conflict and war. So we need to now look back and say, if we want to continue a role in the world, a role of good in the world, which I would like us to play, we need to reevaluate from start to finish how we do that. And that doesn't mean imposing corrupt leaders like we imposed in Afghanistan. That doesn't mean about worrying around esoterical things like we did in Afghanistan, which was around contracts and private business. And it means instead of looking at fundamental things around justice, around food, around employment. And fundamentally, what I think Afghanistan tells us is that you cannot build a country without a little bit of socialism. Because where Afghanistan prospered in the 60s and 70s. Yeah. It was America and Britain that came in and overthrew it when women were leading in Afghanistan because we didn't like the socialism at the time. And if you look at countries around the world where they do well, you have a little bit of socialism. And what I mean by a little bit of socialism is the government takes responsibility for people's healthcare. The government takes responsibility for ensuring people are in employment. The government takes responsibility for local issues like roads and buildings. The government takes responsibility for housing. The government has to be big. When you are building a state, you need a big government. And once the state is built, the government can start to let some of those things... I, of course, don't think the government should let too much of that go, because I am a socialist. But, you know, you can start a free market, but you cannot build a country with a free market. That is impossible. Britain wasn't built with a free market.
Yeah.
America wasn't built with a free market. They were built through government intervention and government protection, protecting their nations and protecting their people. So that's what our lessons, I think.
It was quite a free country in the 60s and 70s. And
it was
pretty stable, but you wouldn't know that from the debate.
There was a deputy, the deputy prime minister was a woman.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Some of the high court judges were women, and they were leftist. And America believes that they supported the Russians. They actually didn't support the Russians. They were independent leftists. But America believed that. So America ploughed money into the Mujahideen to overthrow them. And they were overthrown by nut jobs of religious nut jobs that America supported. And those religious nut jobs were so corrupt and so useless, their students, which is what Taliban means in the local language, the students rose up, and the students had all been trained by Saudi Arabia, again, British and American allies, had ploughed money into training these students up in kind of in backward ideologies. And this isn't kind of, I don't mean just Islam, because the socialists were Muslims. These women were Muslims. I mean Wahhabism, which is one of the most backward and violent and disgusting ideologies on our planet. And it is the ideology of Al-Qaeda, it is the ideology of the Taliban, it is the ideology of Saudi Arabia, and the money and the support for that ideology has come via Saudi Arabia that we continue to protect as our ally. It is our fault from beginning to end, all of this, and we, I'm afraid, failed in trying to rectify our things. Should we have left in the way that we did? No, we should have done it better. The French planned ahead. The French protected their people. So we in Britain have some thinking to do. And Dominic Raab was so feckless and lazy that he was sitting on his sun lounger, and for some reason he thinks that the sea is closed. So it must be evidence that he wasn't on the sun lounger, but he was on holiday. He couldn't even be bothered to pick up the phone to save the lives of people that had helped Britain in this folly. And so I think that, you know, kind of there is a lot to learn here. And there will be a lot of cases to answer. And when we were ringing the Home Office, some of those emails weren't even being answered of desperate people pleading. And we have people here in Brighton. I have constituents who are...
Did you get a response from the government?
Who have family. We have some people who have come back, but some people are still stuck there. Some people have family members still stuck there. And some of those people will die because of the failure of this government to organise themselves.
Yeah.
It's disgraceful.
Do you think we can get involved in countries then and kind of make countries in the way that we think that society should be run in the West? Or how would you go about nation building then? I know that President Biden said it wasn't nation building, but it was an element to that. I mean, they spent enough money over there. They were spending it on something, weren't they?
Well, we should have. If it wasn't nation building, we should have been nation building at that point. The initial reason to go in was not nation building. The initial reason to go in was not women. Interestingly, six months before the Afghan war, there was a hostage plane that landed in
the UK.
In the UK.
Yeah.
And the hostage takers actually were people fleeing the Taliban. Yeah. And they said, we took hostage of this plane to land it here because we want to claim asylum.
Yeah.
The British government, Labour, so happened, but the British government said there was nothing wrong with the Taliban. They sent all those people home. And the only person in Parliament, the only person in Parliament to raise the issue of women's rights, only one person, was the Socialist Campaign Group, the group that I am a member of in Parliament, to say the awful things. 6 months later, we were invading that country. And then 20 years later, we're making up that we invaded that country because of women's rights. Absolute tosh. We and the government, only 6 months before, were sending people back saying there was no problem with women's rights. It's just something we had to live with. So let's ignore, let's put to one side that this was some great liberating force. We went in, and remember, the Taliban were also willing to negotiate, to give up the Al-Qaeda and Osama bin Laden. Now, they didn't want to do it on our terms, but they had agreed to give him up. And that is reported in the press at the time. So again, people making up after the fact that the Taliban were not willing at that moment to give up Osama bin Laden. Again, it's just not true. It is a myth that they're trying to make up because they realise that the war was an absolute disaster. How do you support people? Well, I'm the chair of the All-Party Group for the Kurds, and I've just published a report about how we support the Kurds and how we need to support the Kurds better. First of all, you don't support the enemies of decent secular allies. So you don't support the Mujahideen, you stop supporting Saudi Arabia, you stop supporting people that are going around this world spreading hate and nastiness. That's the first thing that we need to do. The second thing you need to do to start building countries is you support decent, secular opposition forces in those countries. You give them training, you give them support, you give them money. You start to show them about how we can build countries positively. And thirdly, what you do is you offer countries a way in to support with trade and support with a decent movement between peoples, between academics, between, and that's how you bring countries along. And we do have a good track record of it, or should I say the European Union has a relatively good track record with it, because we did it with the Baltic states.
Yeah.
And we did it relatively with the Balkans. Now, there's lots of problems still in the Balkans, but actually Serbia, Kosovo have started to come around, and they've done that because of the influence, not just of the army. The army was important at a certain moment, but because of the money and the development and the access to markets, the access, but also the ability for governments to be able to build up their local infrastructure. And justice was at core. If you remember, Paddy Ashdown said when he was there, one of the key things was building up a decent justice system, building up a decent police force, making sure corruption was tackled. None of those things we did in Afghanistan, but we have done them elsewhere. And not just us, but more importantly, the European Union and the European family coordinating together. So there are ways of doing this. And I genuinely think there are progressives in Iran, there are progressives in Afghanistan, there are progressives in Pakistan that we need to support, but we need to stop supporting some of the really very dangerous ideologies that in the end want absolute death to us, but we support them in Saudi Arabia. And I know I go on about Saudi Arabia a bit, but they are a really dangerous, poisonous view. And if you also look at the Kurds, for example, we withdrew our support for them in Syria because it stopped being strategically interesting for us. And so we abandoned them to the Russians and to Assad and to the Turks. The Turks are our allies, but the Turks continue to repress a group of people that have every time we've asked them to come and stepped up for us. So we need to build long-term relationships with people who want to step up and work with us and support them through the long term. That's, I think, how you nation build. And it's not a golden bullet. There's not a perfect solution for that.
Yeah.
But all of that probably needs to come out in the wash in the next few years, months, and maybe even decades that we'll be exploring this. The immediate thing now is we need to help reallocate Afghan refugees. We need to support people who are stuck in Afghanistan. And actually, this government needs to pull its finger out and able to do that. It needs to make sure Pakistan allows anyone that is given permission to be in Britain to cross the border. And that's one thing that Pakistan needs to do, and we need to diplomacy to make sure that happens. Or any of the other borders as well, you know, Uzbekistan and others. And again, France, we understand, has done that. So they've informed those countries to let their people through. And the reason the countries shut borders is because they're worried that just then loads of Afghanis are going to suddenly pour in. But if they know that they're only coming into Pakistan to be then airlifted out to France or Britain, they'll let those people through.
Yep.
So we could do that immediately. That's a bit of diplomacy that we need to do pretty quickly.
Brilliant. We're going to leave it there. We've run out of time. Thanks for coming today, Lloyd. All the best for the future.
Thank you.
Thanks.